Hi, this is Charles Sanderson. It's been a while since I've recorded one of these ACM videos, but I thought a few people have subscribed to my channel, very kindly, thank you. And so I thought I would do a couple more, inspired by the fact that it seems like people are actually looking at these, which I was never sure somebody would. Okay, so what I'm going to do is have a quick look at dynamic simulation today and use it as a way to try and look at inheritance as well. So for people familiar with object-oriented programming, this may be old hat. And for people who aren't, I'm going to explain it really quickly, and it may be somewhat confusing. But the idea of ACM is that what you can do is you can write models to with one set of equations. And then what you can do is you can actually inherit that model into a larger model and keep all the equations that were in the original model, but supplement them with some additional equations. It's a very powerful technique that means you can reuse your code quite a lot. And so a specific example is here in this model. So what I've done is try to put together a very simple diagram to explain what I'm talking about. So what I'm going to do is model a fermentation. To do a fermentation, what I want to do is have a tank in which I'm going to supplement the basic tank equations with some reaction kinetics that are specific to the fermentation that I'm looking at. In this case, I'm going to go sugar to ethanol and CO2. So what I've got then is I've got a hold-up model that I've written that describes just the differential equations for the mass and energy balance inside of a space. I haven't described much about that space, and the reason I've done that is that I can then reuse that hold-up model to describe a liquid hold-up, a vapor hold-up, or to sort of string together a whole bunch of spaces and discretize the internal volume of a reactor or something. So that allows me to have all the hold-up equations together in one place and then reuse them multiple times if I want to. For the case of a tank, I'm going to have one copy of that hold-up, and I'm going to embed that into a larger model. That larger model is then going to describe things like the shape of the tank, so I can get dimensions and level of and control the level in the tank and that sort of thing. I can also have ports so that I can move material in and out of the unit operation. And then finally, the fermenter takes that tank model and then supplements the hold-up mass energy balance with equations to describe specific reactions. In ACM, that looks a little bit like this. Oops, I thought I had those open already. So here's my fermenter model. And what I'm going to do that describes all the details of the fermenter. And then in my library, I've got my submodel, which is a holdup. And so here's my holdup equations. So in the holdup model, what I do is I describe a variable called Rmade, the rate at which material is created, and that I'm going to fix at zero by default. So by default, that is essentially a zero term. It doesn't do anything. So when I come down to my mass balance here, where I say dmass by the time of component I, I say that's equal to the flow in times the composition, the mass fraction in, minus the flow out times the composition of the mass fraction of component I out, plus that rate at which stuff is made. But as I said, that's fixed at zero by default. So by default, it's just a rate of accumulation is in minus out, as you would expect. When I come up to the fermenter wrapper model, though, what I'm then doing is I'm going to come in, I'm going to free up that rate at which stuff is made for the components I've described as reactive. So those that's created reacting degrees of freedom, and then for each of those degrees of freedom, I'm then putting in an equation that says the rate of reaction of component I is equal to some equation. In this case, it's the amount of biomass times the specific rate of reaction times the stoichiometry and the molecular weight to give me my rate at which I'm making each individual component. Okay, so with that, I've now described my reaction. I've got my fermenter up and running. To have a quick look at the flow sheet, what I've done is I'm going to try and describe a batch or fed batch fermentation. So I've got my hold-up volume. At the moment, I'm using a tank, so I'm not allowing vapor to escape. I could write a more complicated model where I have mass transfer between a liquid hold-up and a vapor hold-up, and then an escape route for the vapor out of the fermentation itself. In this case, I'm cheating and just doing a shortcut. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come out of my liquid hold-up through a flash where I remove the carbon dioxide with any entrained water and ethanol, and then recycle that material back into the tank. So if I set this flow rate high enough, then I'll more or less be in equilibrium. I won't have CO2 building up in my fermenter, and it's a reasonable first pass approximation for what I'm hoping is going to happen in my fermenter. There's a chance that I'm going to develop heat in the fermentation, so I've got a leg where I bring that degassed broth out through an external cooler and return that to the fermenter, and the rate at which I flow through there is going to be determined by this temperature control. And then the final leg is the removal of material that I've got on a level control. For a batch or a fed batch, obviously that flow rate would normally be zero. But by throwing a level controller in there, what I can do is I can have a steady state model that allows me to converge it and get the whole thing set up and running, and then I can flip it over into dynamics. I strongly recommend, where possible, getting your flow sheet built in steady state and making it work, even if you are going to ultimately run it in dynamic mode, just because it's a whole lot easier usually to debug steady state models and understand what's going on there. And so you can eliminate a large fraction of the problems you might have by going through and doing that as steady state first. To make it a reasonable starting point, what I've done is I've got my steady state set up with a very low level, so 0.1% level in the fermenter. I've got my inoculum flowing in, and I've got my biomass, my sugar flowing in. And so that's going to set my fermentation up. It's not a very realistic model. The sharp-eyed among you will see that I'm feeding 30% sugar. That's probably going to cause osmotic stress to my bugs. I'm not trying to do a real fermentation here. I'm just trying to demonstrate the concepts. Okay, so I've got my flow sheet set up. I've configured it all, and I've confirmed that it runs in steady state. The next thing to do is to flip over into dynamic mode. Although it's redundant, I often run in initialization mode before I do a steady state, before I do a dynamic simulation. The reason for that is it makes sure that all the equations work in dynamic formulations. So you want to make sure that you have a different set of degrees of freedom when you're in dynamic mode as compared to steady state mode. In steady state mode, you just have to make sure your algebraic equations are balanced, so you have the same number of variables as you have knowns and equations. In dynamic mode, in addition to that requirement, you also have your differential equations, and so you need to make sure that you have your initial conditions defined for each of your ordinary differential equations. So you end up having, if you've got n ordinary differential equations, you need to have n starting points for each of those initial conditions, and so that gives you an additional set of variables that you want to make sure you have set to initial correctly. So in this fermentation, for example, I'm initializing the total holdup in the system, the mass fraction of all the components except for water. So I've got n mass balances, so I've got n minus one mass fractions plus the total mass to give me n components. And then I've also got an energy balance, so I need an additional N, so I'm initializing my temperature. So that gives me N plus one initial conditions to make sure that I'm all square. You'll see that the model, in steady state mode, you have the red triangle pointing up or pointing down. In dynamic mode, you have the same thing to tell you if your algebraic equations are balanced, but in addition to that, embedded within the green square, you see I have a red triangle saying I'm under specified by one, and that's because I've set my temperature to free rather than having it at initial. If it's back to initial, then I'm all square and ready to go. Okay, so initialization tests that balance, but it also tests to make sure that your problem is still feasible in ODE formulation. And then finally, you get a snapshot for your starting condition, which is also kind of useful if you want to rewind to the starting point of a dynamic simulation. Okay, having done all that, I can now flip over into dynamic mode. The last things I need to do are then set myself up with something to look at as results. So what I've done at the flowsheet level using one of these forms where I created a new plot, I've set myself up with a plot of the outgoing ethanol, glucose, and biomass concentrations. So I can see how that changes as a function of time. And then to have the model do something interesting, I've also written a task. This is described in the task editor language in the Aspen model help contents. So what I'm doing here is I'm coming in at 0 hours, so immediately set the inoculation flow to zero. So I've got my, it's currently at 1 kilogram an hour, that'll be set to zero. It sets the level control set point from 10 to the minus 3 to 99%, so it's going to fill the tank up. So the level control will shut off this flow, and then essentially everything will then be recirculated inside the fermenter. I'll wait until the level reaches 99%. In other words, my vessel is full. I'll then shut off my sugar feed going into the system. I'm giving myself a feedback notice, so this will print something in the messages window down here. You can determine the level of debug that you want these messages to come out at. By default, it's 1. I always set it to 0 because I want to see the messages, but you can set it to, if it's a debug message, you may choose to set it to a higher level. So then I set the flow to 0. I wait until the glucose concentration leaving the fermenter is less than 10 to the minus 5, and then I say, okay, I'm done, and I stop. I pause the simulation. Okay, let's see how that works. I'm going to hit run, and you'll see it's telling me what's going on in the fermentation. You can see it's plotting the increase in concentration of stuff. You maybe saw flip by the level reached its maximum. And there we go, we finished. We've got the message saying I completed at 16 hours. If I come back up here, you'll see I've got the message saying the fermentation was full at about 10 hours. So there you have it, a dynamic simulation and a set of results that you can see graphically. You can flip this over into a history, copy and paste that into Excel or something to look at or store and do more details. Okay, that's dynamic simulation in a nutshell. Hope that's useful. Thank you. Bye-bye.